Hello, Internet. Welcome to another episode of That Random Podcast Show, set in the not-too-distant future, next Sunday AD, starring two podcast hosts, not unlike you and me. They were out in space, dealing with stuff. But then, a wacky scientist captured us and forced us to make a podcast show about movies, games, music, and cartoons of a nostalgic variety. This, unfortunately, is a bit where I'm trying to mix together two franchises. I'm doing my best Rod Serling as we speak, and failing horribly. But I am actually the host, one of them. Name is Tyler Chansey, and with me, as always, is my co-pilot and the guide that makes sure we don't crash horribly into a meteorite, Michael Mosley.
Okay, so I know nothing about this reference you're doing. I mean, I know what you're doing, but I know nothing about this, so I cannot contribute. How's it going, folks?
I wanted to sing it, but you said my singing was terrible, so I decided to Rod Serling it up. Get some Twilight Zone.
I know that we talk about music and whatnot on this show, but I don't think we're ready to do a musical episode just yet.
Of course not. I don't have the musical program set up just yet. I'm still figuring out the layers. It's happening.
Should we do a musical episode? That would be like really interesting because that'll take up a lot of time. You know what we should? Like once we reach episode 100, we'll do a musical episode.
An entire musical episode? My God, I'm not a new Sondheim. I don't have that much creativity in me. I do it in small bursts here and there. It's like a pulse, like a sonar or something. But but yes, as I have mentioned in our intro, a lot of stuff has happened recently since our last recording. A lot of premieres of certain nostalgic properties has been coming up. But I believe we'll be prudent, of course, to maybe talk briefly about what has gone down this past weekend with the new episode of the return of Samurai Jack.
Which I have actually saw like right before we started recording because I kept forgetting to see it because I end up getting busy with other work and projects. But yeah,
that always happens
a lot. And it surprisingly enough, it had nothing to do with this podcast technically.
You keep telling yourself that. But yeah, not really a whole lot we really can't discuss in this episode because oddly enough, a lot of plot happens in this episode. Then again, that happens almost every episode. It's why it's maddening, really, to talk about them at length, because we mentioned this before, the show has kept going, and I actually thought, almost in the first 5 minutes, this episode pulled a major faux pas, and then it sidestepped, and I'm like, damn it, Tartakovsky, you were just trolling me. You were actively, consistently trolling me, specifically. Not the fans, me specifically. Every episode. I can imagine you with your little troll face, you're storyboarding all the darn time. I'm gonna grimdark this up. Wait, no I'm not. Ha, you mad, bro? Frick. I'm of course talking about the episode where we finally get to see what has become of the fan favorite character of the Scotsman.
Yes. And like, yeah, you know, it's weird you brought up that we can't say a whole lot because a lot happened in this episode that will be seen as spoilers. So actually, by the time this episode comes out, it should be okay to talk about it anyway, because not like the rest of the internet is going to talk about it.
But yes, yeah, so you know what? You know, let's put a spoiler warning up quickly, just in case for some ridiculous reason you've been staying quiet about the show. But yeah, the opening of the episode is the Scotsman gets an army together to try to storm Aku's tower, and he's an old man now, but he's like being wheeled into battle with a wheelchair, which I thought was just the most hilariously awesome thing ever. And then and then Aku kills him
in glorious fashion. Like if I had to watch the Scotsman die, I'm glad it was like this. This was the most awesome.
Yes.
At first, I was like, oh no, Aku's gonna kill him. Then when it happened, I was like, you know what? I'm satisfied with that death. Like, that is a satisfying death for the Scotsman.
I'm actually, like I said, I'm angry because the one thing that's a very easily manipulative to do when it comes to a dark or gritty reimagining or return of a series is usually it is to kill off a fan favorite character to show, oh no, things are more real now, things are more realistic now. And in that context, it would have been funny to see if that's how the Scotsman dies. But if you think more about it, if it just ended there, it would have been a really manipulative way of going about it, because Scotsman just basically gets an army together and is like, all right, we're going to go in, and we're going to kill Aku, and then Aku just shows him and just, like, flattens the army in, like, 2 seconds. And then he basically says, no, go on, I'll distract him, and then basically wheels his wheelchair up to the all-powerful Master of Evil, created from the primordial darkness of the creation of the universe, and says, "Hey, you're just a big baby, big old baby, staying all inside your tower while the samurai is out doing good." And then Aku is like, "I have no time for this," and just vaporizes him with laser vision.
That's the one thing that brought up for me that I thought of when I saw that scene. Was like, Aku just can't stay happy. Like, he is mad depressed right now. And then I kind of want to see,
why did he bring up the samurai?
Yeah, I was kind of hoping like this was going to be an Aku episode, because
I thought the entire episode was going to be him just like you know stretching his legs and just destroying these big armies. And I'm like, nope, it's over in like 10 seconds. And he's bored.
Yeah, and I'm kind of sad about that, because like I like to see an episode focused on Aku and his depression that he's going through.
His malaise.
It's so weird. Like it's like one of those things where
he's conquered the world. He's basically enslaved the populace, and the last big credible threat to him is basically still running wild. And he's like, you know what? I don't even care anymore.
Jack still bothers him by just his existence. And it's like when the coyote caught the roadrunner, didn't know what to do. Like this whole time,
he's like, I gotcha. Oh yeah, the last episode, he catches the roadrunner.
Yeah, what do I do now? It's great to see that with villains. Like, yep, you got exactly what you wanted, and now what do? Like your whole journey was trying to get this one thing.
Well. No, here's the thing, with Aku, I kind of like how they kept that going, but with Scotsman, back to Scotsman, when Scotsman died, I thought, oh great, I was actually imagining a bunch of fanboys getting really angry about that, because if you take it out of context, what happens later, Scotsman basically Leroy Jenkins'd himself at Aku and got ganked, to use, MMO terminology. And for a lot of people, Scotsman may have been a boisterous, you know, bullheaded guy, but he wasn't a moron. Like, he knew not to insult his wife, for one. And for a lot of people, that could have just been a manipulative, oh no, tug at the heartstrings. But then he kind of reveals why he did it, and it's like, okay, Tartakovsky, screw you, you're still awesome. Because he has an army of daughters, and I love that. He has, like, an army of battle warrior daughters. I'm like, wow, a one-man population explosion. Way to go, Scotsman. And apparently he used some Celtic magic to bring himself back as a ghost in order to help him keep the fight going. And then it ends with him saying, we gotta find Samurai Jack. He'll lead our army. And I'm like, well, shit. I think... And that's where I'm like, okay, this turned from being a manipulative character death into being a setup for what I have to assume has to be the finale of this season. This big, final push for Aku's hideout.
Yeah, and I can't wait to see that, because the Scotsman now has Celtic magic with his sword, and that's in his...
He's Obi-Wan Kenobi. He pulled an Obi-Wan Kenobi. Yeah,
and it's going to be great to see Ashi. I keep wanting to call her Ashu. Ashi and Jack team up with the Scotsman and his daughters to fight Aku and probably even the rest of the world, because Jack has gained this great reputation and respect amongst the people. So,
oh yeah, 50-60 years of fighting nonstop will do that for you.
Yeah, and it's always great to see when Jack goes to a place that we've never seen before, that is obvious. He has been there before. Like, in this episode, he conquered a serpent with no issue, and my only thought was, he's done this before. Like some of the things Jack pulled, you can tell, after these 50 years, off-screen, he's been busy.
He put ranks into animal handling. He knows how to mount and tame animals. It's awesome. But personally, the big thrust of the episode actually did have to be how Jack actually helped Ashi kind of learn more about the world. And once again, this is still a show that shows rather than tells. And once again, a lot of stuff was well done here. Like, I mentioned this before multiple times we talked about the past episodes. It looks like the show was following through with what I wanted with Jack. His madness hallucinations were much more downplayed. Like, Ghost Jack doesn't appear in the entire episode, and only when hallucinations happened, it's because Ashi wasn't there. And you mentioned before that it seems these hallucinations are more of a coping mechanism due to him being alone for so long, and now that's definitely coming into light in this episode. But it also shows that because of Jack mentoring Ashi, not lecturing, not condescending, not mansplaining it to her, dear God, I hate that term, it's him mentoring her and showing her that's actually helping bring back the best qualities of him. And also showing off just how great the art direction is, as always, and showing how Ashi eventually kind of sees things Jack's way and becomes a true ally. And it's great. Like, the most haunting one is that they go to Aku City and Jack, like, you know, basically MacGyvers himself together like a pimp outfit or something. The big hat, the suit. And you find out that Aku basically has gone more than just conquering what I'm going to assume is Earth. He actually brings in refugees. Not refugees, he actually helps harbor intergalactic criminals and gangsters and says, Oh, I see, you're evil like me. Here, don't worry about it. You want a place to lay low and we'll, you know, keep you fed? Sure. All you gotta do is just take the land from these innocent and weak little children over here. That should be fun for you, right? Oh, yeah, total fun. Yeah, definitely. I'm like, beautiful. Horrible. I'm already disgusted.
You know, and seeing that one scene goes to show, like, all that destruction wasn't just Aku destroying everything. It was pretty much Aku allowing people to run their own way.
Might makes right in his world.
Yeah, yeah, and for his world, it's the strongest survives. If you
might makes right, social Darwinism, yeah, if you will.
You're not strong enough to fend for yourself. Why should you exist? Like, if you can't fight, you have no purpose. And we even see that with his daughters. They're trained up that way. Yeah,
the cult.
They're trained up that way. It's like, oh, if you can't fight,
death is failure.
If you can't fight, if you can't fend for yourself, if you can't kill without being killed, you don't deserve to be here in the first place. So it's actually kind of cool to see that. Like, now we see part of the reason why Aku's so bored. He doesn't do anything. He just allows people to run their own way.
As I said before, though, he has become too complacent and basically winning, conquering the world he's on. It's like, well, everything's mine now. Crap, everything's mine now. What do I do now? But, like I said, the first half of the episode was basically Jack and Ashi. The second half is where things got pretty freaking dark, actually. Like, I knew the show was going to be darker before, but this took it to a whole other level. The second half of the show involves Ashi and Jack finding out that a village got destroyed, and according to a survivor, they took the children and put them in basically a labor camp.
Yeah, child, like, slavery. That's how dark this show gets. They actually have child slavery in here.
Oh no. Oh no. Here's the thing. I was thinking child slavery as well. It's like, oh wow, they got dark. And then they get to the facility, and I found out it got even worse than that. Weaponized child soldiers. As if it was basically a good job to kind of show a parallel also to Ashi, what happened to the daughters.
Hideo Kojima would be proud of this episode. It's like, yeah, you know what? If I ever made a cartoon, this is the direction I'd take.
Yeah, it had to be like the kids were like hit with like a microchip or something that made them go feral due to a signal or something.
Which when you heard it, I was like, oh wow, that's pretty cool. But I thought it was just because of their nature, like a dog with a high-pitched with a high-pitched whistle, they'll be like, oh, only they can hear it. It's like, no, it was a microchip, and only Ashi was able to hear it with her enhanced training. And which makes me wonder, what the world is she? Like,
it's really difficult to tell with that,
does Aku know about them? Does Aku know about this cult?
No. We have to assume no, because they keep going on about how he will once again grace them with his presence. And I get the feeling he's like, yeah, sure, whatever, praise me, whatever, and just kind of went back to his tower, and they are like, as you wish, my lord, you know, without kind of figuring that out. But yeah, So I remember this episode. Ashi is trying to like find a way to shut off the signal. Meanwhile, Jack is trying his best not to be torn to shreds by these little killer little children. They're like 5 or 6 years old, like toddlers, and trying not to horribly harm them. Because here's the thing I like about realism is so great about the show. When episode one of the series began, he was rocking this like really gnarly looking like Shogun battle armor, multiple guns, multiple weapons. And then once episode 3 rolled around, he basically got reduced to holding nothing but, like, some whatever spears or whatever he could whip together himself, and no armor. He was loinclothing it up. That is still the case in episode 5. He has not replenished his armor, he hasn't gotten new weapons, he is still bare-fisting bare-fisting these challenges with nothing but the clothes on his back, and he's struggling. Which was a great continuation of things.
Yeah, plus it helped that he wasn't actually trying to harm the children. Like, yeah, like he was throwing them off, but he wasn't throwing punches. He was just wiping them off of them or tossing them off to the side.
And that right there is another indication of what I like about the show. It isn't eye candy; it's eye protein. It could have been Jack fights the children. A lesser director or whatever could have easily had to be that Jack was punching them or knocking them out, you know, Batman style. Like, oh, they don't know what they're doing. I'll knock them out. That should be safe. No, knocking people out isn't like Hollywood. That leads to long-term damage. Not to mention, you're punching out children, you freak show.
Plus, Ashi's torture scene. Oh, man. That was something else.
I'm not gonna lie, that was very painful to look at, but also that could have easily been way too on the nose. In fact, it felt very on the nose. Like, my gosh, children are so easily manipulated. They're so easily easy conditioned to get to kill. He says while looking Ashi in the eye and messing with her. It's like, gee, I wonder if somebody's gonna have an arc here anytime soon. It felt kind of on the nose, but they sold it.
Yeah, it was great. I think it was a great reassurance to Ashi that everything Jack said was true, and that this whole thing about it goes to show that she's in the right state of mind. Like, yeah, she's been brainwashed, but she could also think for herself.
Again, she is human. She is human. She has the capacity to change. That learning can be undone. It just takes a lot. But then we get to the finale of the episode, and it was a surprising shock. It ends with Jack believing that the children died. Like, you see him, like, drop to his knees, like, no! How could this have happened? And we finally get a scene where he addresses the horseman, that ghostly horseman that's been popping up in his hallucinations. And all we get is, it is time. You're right. And then Jack vanishes. And that's the episode. With Ashi like, where did Jack go? Oh gosh, where did Jack go? And that's where the episode ended.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. Once we saw, because usually with this kind of show, with this show, or at least what we've seen so far, when you see something smoking, it's usually because they're done for. And from the way those children had suffered after Ashi destroyed the frequency, I can understand why Jack went through what he went through.
It was very convincing.
Oh my goodness, yeah, like, they were in pain. Like it really did look like if that chip went off, it probably fried their brains. Yeah, or something. And Jack, you can tell he's done. The death of children is it for Jack. He can't take any more of this world. 50 years of that, and this is enough.
Yes, and once again, a ballsy show because it looks like the next episode is going to be focusing on Ashi looking for Jack. On a show called Samurai Jack, there's going to be an episode where the focus looks like it'll be on Ashi.
Well, I think that might be a good thing because it shows her.
It's a very smart call.
Oh yeah, because it could show a continued growth of Ashi, and he could finally get an answer to this samurai horseman and the hallucination Jack has of death. Because let's face it, if by this episode,
I don't think it's death. I actually don't think it's death. I think it might actually be despair.
Well, yeah, but it might be a representation of death, or at least a honorable samurai's death. Like maybe Jack just.
Harakiri incarnate.
Yeah, basically. Like this is Jack's time, as he said, his time. Like this is Jack's time, and Jack has chosen himself that now is the right time to end all of this.
Once again, this could have easily been manipulative and shock for shock's sake, but it was the right moment to pull at the right time, showing that great attention to detail that Tartakovsky is great at excelling. I go a bit further, a bit more into detail, actually, with my animation deviation review of the episode. But I think we kind of hit on the broad note. So, yeah, another good episode. Once again, very lean, almost no filler. like the closest thing to filler I could possibly imagine was the story that Jack told Ashi about the creation of the stars told him by his mother. But even then, I really can't even call that filler because it's some needed levity and charm.
And it went by so fast. It was like maybe, what, a 25-second story? Like, it went by pretty fast. Yeah. Now, my favorite filler, if you even call it filler, was the serpent ride. That camera movement, why they flew through the air.
Oh, beautiful.
Oh, man.
It brought me back to Spirited Away. It was well done.
And it's even better since Gendy decided to go with the style of not using outlines for his characters. So everything doesn't actually blend together. It's not all these big dark lines blending together. And it works so well, even with this scene, because the way the camera moves, you can separate Ashi from the sea and the sky and the serpent itself. So everything looks separate and looks layered and looks fine. And the camera movement works so well for such a art style.
Absolutely. Well, Michael, there was also another little animation return that you have... saw, and you've been tweeting about it, so I guess you'll have to talk about it. You managed to catch the Season 7 premiere of My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. Please take it away.
All right, I'm not going to make you suffer through all this, because...
like I said, I stopped sometime around Season 5. Right. Around Season 5. Like, I like what I've seen so far, but... For some reason, when I found out the Cutie Mark Crusaders finally got their cutie marks, I'm like, I think I'm done with the show. I don't know why, but I'm like, I'm done now.
Okay, well, it was then the season premiere. They always do the first two episodes. The first episode was, oddly enough, somewhat focused on Princess Celestia, a character that even if you've been watching the show since season one, episode one, we don't know a whole lot about her.
She runs the stuff. She's awesome.
Well, I mean, a little bit we find out about her. Her past is kind of messed up. But, yeah, we find out a little more about Twilight being her student and where she and how all that worked out for him. Because in this episode, Twilight was giving Discord, Trixie, Thorax, and Starlight Glimmer awards for helping save Equestria in the season 6 finale.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, nice. So it was a nice little continuation. They had this nice little celebration that had, of course, all the royalty there. Celestia was there, Luna, Shining Armor, yep. And Cadence was there as well.
I think you mentioned in your Twitter feed that Bulk Biceps also pops up in
the episode. He pops up in episode 2.
I'm not going to lie, I do just love the running visual gag that his Bulk Biceps. He's like, rip, but he's got tiny little wings.
Yeah.
Oh, flap.
Yeah, he's... Oh, and not to mention his... he doesn't do leg days because his legs are small. He has these great big muscles with tiny little legs. So, but Bulk is a really nice stallion. So...
Speaking from a guy that spent over 12 years in Taekwondo, you never skip leg day.
Well, he's a lifter, all right? He lifts. He makes it perfectly all clear right, he's fine. A lifter. And, in this first episode, Discord, of course, plays mind games with Twilight, and she still falls for this. And he tricks her into trying to make a surprise announcement dealing with Starlight Glimmer, because Starlight Glimmer is Twilight's student. Well, Twilight ends up coming with a plan that, I don't know what to do. I just got her this silly little mirror with pictures on it.
So this is basically our crisis. You know, John Delancey's Discord doing
his best. And Twilight...
Stirring the pot.
And Twilight is known for losing her mind rather quickly.
Over such details. She's been neurotic.
Over the smallest things, she'll go crazy.
Absolutely.
So she spends the first part of the episode... trying to figure out a plan of what she can do. She has 3 years of friendship lessons lined up for Starlight until she realizes Starlight has pretty much finished all her friendship lessons. So she has to figure out on the spot how she's going to make this big announcement.
You haven't graduated yet. You still have to peel this onion. You still have to do this. You still have to do that.
Well, the other thing is she ends up going with the plan of graduating Starlight anyway. And this, of course, well, not trying not to jump ahead of myself. She gets a story from Princess Celestia, who gives her advice on what to do next. And she ended up figuring out that, oh, she has to send Starlight away the same way Celestia did to her. And of course, this leads to a few funny jokes. We find out that Celestia herself used to freak out all the time because she didn't, because she freaked out about Twilight leaving and getting into danger and getting into trouble.
Oh my gosh, like a fussy mom, like sending her kid off to school.
Oh my goodness, yes. It was.
Or sending her off to camp or whatever, like, oh my gosh, she's brushing her teeth, is she eating well? Oh my gosh, I hope she's making friends.
Oh yeah, it's all great that because throughout these, the past six seasons, we've seen smart, composed, always know what to do, Celestia. And this.
I am composed and I am a queen. I am
princess.
Perfectly fine.
She's a princess.
Season 7.
Thank you.
Oh yeah, she is technically a princess. And then season 7 happens, and suddenly she's a mom. Well, oh my gosh!
The thing is, like, there always seemed to be like this mother-daughter bond between Celestia and Twilight, because Twilight would talk big about Princess Celestia, and in this one we really get to see it because Celestia will pace back and forth in the throne room, coming up with all these wild fantasies of Twilight getting in trouble and getting in danger. And it is.
Wait a minute! This isn't Yak Snow! And they beat her down.
It's funny because she's pacing back and forth, like, what if she gets in trouble? What if she runs into a manticore? What if this happens? What if that happens? What if she meets these kind of ponies? I'm like, jeez, man. It sounds like a mother who doesn't want to let her child go anywhere. Not even outside. You're not allowed to go outside because it might rain. It might rain.
In fact, inside is just as dangerous. Let me wrap you up in bubble wrap and give you a straw so you can breathe.
Close enough. And we also find out that even back in season 1, when we find out that Celestia planned for Twilight to go meet Rainbow Dash and Pinkie Pie and the rest.
Everybody else. The main
six. We come to find out she was actually supposed to meet them way before then. And Celestia actually stopped herself from doing that because she was afraid of letting Twilight go. Because if Twilight made friends,
a little parallel story. It sounds like Celestia's was worried about Twilight. Twilight's worried about sending Starlight off.
And so
we got like a parallel.
Yeah, and
going
it was all part of Celestia's lesson to Twilight. It's like, yeah, it's going to happen. I made that mistake because I waited far too long to let you go make friends, and she pretty much admit that she was being selfish. Because she said that if she was afraid that if she let Twilight go and make new friends, that Twilight may not need her anymore. So in a way, it is
very heartbreaking if you think about it.
It was great because we finally learned a little more about Celestia. She had a little bit of character growth, and we can see that not only is she imperfect, but she could also be a little selfish at times too. And of course, we're reminded that she didn't want to send Twilight.
She isn't the all-knowing princess of the sun that always knows right. No, she
has
flaws.
She has
huge
flaws. And of course, she reminded herself that she did the same thing to her sister through a different situation when she sent her to the moon because of the Nightmare Moon thing.
And we saw how that went down.
We really got to see multiple sides of Celestia. Mom Celestia, teacher Celestia, sad sister Celestia, sad mom Celestia. It was nice. It was a nice bit of character development.
That sounds great. So, anything else happened in this big two-parter?
In the first episode was easily the funniest because not only because of the character development, but because Discord.
And then I'm guessing part two is where the emotion came in.
Well, this one they went back to a lesson mode. Yeah,
as always.
In this first one, there's a little more character development, and we find out that pretty much the whole episode is a punchline for Discord. Because it turns out Discord wasn't trying to tease Twilight into graduating Starlight or making fun of her for being her teacher. Instead, he was trying to convince her to let Starlight move in with him at his place. And it comes up with this joke like, Oh, so that was the big surprise. I was trying to hint at let her move into my place. Way to pick up on my vibes, Twilight. It's like, wait, are you serious? This whole time.
You've been trolled. Yes. You've been trolled. You Aww. Probably should fold when the only winning move is not to play.
Yeah, and it was a wonderful episode. It was a great way to start off. And episode two.
It's always fun to see what Discord does in the episodes
he's in. Oh, yeah, which is why I'm glad he was in the first season, the first episode.
Season premiere,
because
yeah.
It really does show that he's actually part of the group. He's actually a part of the friends and all that. He's not just some simple secondary background character that he has been in the past season or two, with the exception of the season six finale. But episode two focused on the friendship between Trixie and Starlight Glimmer. And come to find out, the great and powerful Trixie is just as annoying as we thought she was, even if you're friends with her.
Yeah, I kind of figured that. That's just her personality type.
Yeah, and unfortunately, even with someone like Starlight Glimmer, who is great friends with Trixie, like, they become friends rather quickly, and you wonder how that dynamic works.
There's still some annoyances that kind of happens. I wouldn't say, it sounds like it's not really annoyance, it's just little kind of stepping stones.
Oh, yeah, like, you can tell, like, it's the little things that get to Starlight. Like, at the beginning of the episode,
It kind of sounds like how people keep saying they like Pinkie Pie, but I keep feeling as if that can very easily backfire because she's fun in small doses.
Oh, there were episodes about that too with I believe Rainbow Dash. But
moving on.
What's up? Oh, okay.
Moving on. Go on.
Yeah. Oh man. Yeah. In the beginning of this second episode, Starlight is making cheesecake cupcakes for...
I can already feel my waistline expanding hearing that sentence.
Yeah, I actually want to try it myself. She was making cheesecake cupcakes for Twilight and her friends as they go on a friendship retreat. And Trixie is trying to learn new magic by turning an object into a teacup. Yeah.
Oh, no.
And she couldn't do it. And Starlight helps her figure out how to do magic and how to turn objects into teacups, which of course Trixie goes crazy and turns everything into a teacup, from frying pans to cups to plates to even pots, like kettles.
Perfect.
Like, even kettles. Perfect. Kettles turn to little teacups.
Perfect. Everything's teacups. Now all we need is a bunch of candlesticks and we can recreate Be Our Guest.
Right. Hey, careful, the internet's probably already on it. But
Be
Oh man. But Trixie ends up ruining Starlight's cupcake cheesecake thing, and even turns this bag of icing she had into a teacup poodle cheesecake thing.
That sounds horrifying.
It's actually more adorable than I'm making it sound.
Okay. But, okay.
She ruins her meal.
Stuff gets ruined. Tensions rise, but things
somewhat literally. We come to find out that Starlight creates angry little magic clouds. This red thunderous cloud that comes out of her horn whenever she gets so angry, but she holds it in.
Oh, okay.
We're dealing with wild magic here. So soon, Trixie...
Things escalate from there, and I'm guessing this is the crux of the second half.
Yeah, technically, yes. Trixie literally bottles her anger, and pretty soon, Trixie just keeps getting on her nerves with little things.
Literally bottling her anger in like a jar.
Yes, into this little glass bottle.
Okay, say no more, Michael. I just need to say that is a great visual. That's a great visual, especially since this is still a kids show aimed at kids, and that's a great bit of visual storytelling.
It was great visual metaphor. I really enjoyed it. I was like, oh, okay, I'll admit that's pretty creative and that's pretty cool. She's literally bawling up her anger.
But of course, it's wild magic, so things go crazy. A lesson is learned about not doing that and expressing your feelings towards stuff, right. I'm guessing.
Yes, it's actually a lesson for Trixie herself. One thing leads to another. Trixie makes Twilight's magical map board, map table disappear.
Yeah, in that castle.
Yes, so most of the episode was Trixie and Starlight going on a wild goose chase of going to all these places that Trixie went to because she forgot where she teleported the map.
They're chasing for the MacGuffin, the thing that
again. Luckily, we know what this MacGuffin is and what it does. So they run around Ponyville looking for it, and there's a running joke with Book Bicep's new job, which is selling cinnamon hot cinnamon nuts or something like that. And
that sounds so manly, bro.
When Book Bicep is selling it, yeah, man, it sounds it's actually pretty awesome.
That is so manly. Come on.
There's actually a joke about that later on. So pretty soon the glass bottle breaks and it infects Book Bicep and two other ponies who begins to attack Trixie.
So they're foaming at the mouth, all red in the eyes.
Yeah, red attacking. In the eyes, yelling at Trixie, throwing stuff. Oh no, I'm sorry. It was Granny Smith. Granny Smith was the third person.
Oh my gosh, no. I love Granny Smith.
Angry Granny Smith is something else. She tried throwing a purse at her. That was a pretty funny joke because she couldn't throw a purse even when she was angry. But the three ponies start attacking Starlight, and she can't figure out for the life of her why they're so angry at her. She even tries to apologize for something.
Really? You don't know.
She's so full of herself that she didn't realize all those things that the ponies were yelling at her about was the stuff she did to Starlight. And we also figured out that balling that.
Okay, that's okay. You know what? That's actually great. They focused on the fault was Trixie's because it was a lack of self awareness.
Yes, yeah, like
about her actions. Yeah. Okay, bravo to that.
Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah,
that's,
yeah. This whole thing. Same, yeah, this whole thing was a lesson for Trixie, even though it could have easily been, oh, you shouldn't bottle up your anger kind of lesson. It was more like you should also take
bottling up your anger is a problem, but you should But usually, whenever that happens,
it's usually somebody is. There's a second party involved, and luckily, this episode did focus on that. It's like, yeah, people bottle up their anger, but it's probably because of something you did, and you should probably try and realize that you're actually doing something. So it was a great lesson towards Trixie.
That's actually some pretty solid writing.
It was a well done episode.
It sounds like season 7 is off to a good
start. It is so far. So, plus, there was a song in season 7 that they use as a punchline for a joke, and it was great. And I'm not gonna spoil what it was because if you watch episode 2, it's a really good joke.
Fair enough. Well, let's move away from animation because actually some sci-fi and science-oriented stuff was released recently. For instance, there's a teaser that came out for the return of Bill Nye the Science Guy to television in a Netflix series called Bill Nye Saves the World. It's going to be focused more towards adults and focusing on different subject matter, but still with that very quintessential Bill Nye charm. And I saw a trailer for it dropped through Bill's official Twitter feed recently, and oh boy, it's like I'm back in elementary school science class all over again. Except, you know, the show grew up with me, and I can't wait to see what happens.
It doesn't sound weird at all. People are waiting for this. Like, people are super excited that out of all the science shows that's on TV, everybody is super excited for Bill Nye, the Science Guy, the guy who pretty much taught us bits and pieces of science, who got people who didn't even like science interested in science when they were a kid. Having him come back at a time like this is wonderful.
So much enthusiasm he brought to that show, so much charm, and a pretty fun theme song as well. And the fact is, he didn't stop after that show. He kept going. He still talks to politicians, goes to courts and champions the merits of science, which is hilarious because He himself doesn't even have a doctorate. He has a bachelor's degree. Yeah, and not only that,
but he also does debates. He does scientific debates, too. I saw one he did with creationists, and I was like, oh, this is...
Oh, those are beautiful. Those are delicious.
Those are pretty fun. Pretty fun to watch. He also has Tyler the Creator to do the new theme for his show.
Oh, which that's great.
Maybe Netflix. There we go. Gosh darn it. Yeah, Netflix actually showed the theme song that was made for the new show. And I gotta admit, I've listened to that thing so many times. It's actually just as catchy as the original theme. So
that is
it's great because Tyler the Creator is actually I was waiting for you or something like that. He's actually a fan of the old show, just like the rest of us were when we were kids. And he kept the central theme of the theme song, the whole fast paced build parts.
And he simply changed
up the tempo, and changed it up enough to where it felt like, yes, it's homage to the old one, but you can tell it's for the new show. So it's not even a remix or a remake. It's pretty much a reimagining, and it works so well.
Yes. So Bill Nye the Science Guy is getting to. This is probably the first like science focused show I've been interested in seeing again since Neil deGrasse Tyson helped bring was start on that Return of Cosmos, which I really liked. So, great. So now Cosmos is ran its course, and now Bill Nye the Science Guy is coming back. I'm like, science. Thank you, Jesse Pinkman.
Yeah, and one of the teasers they showed was Bill talking about the importance of vaccinations, and while he might have gotten rid of the sound effects, he still kept it interesting by using props and by using visual aids, and
he appears to be having guest stars as well. I noticed they credited Donald Faison popping up on an episode, and I'm like,
he's gonna have a few famous people on there, which should help the newer, younger generation get into it. And it's in
the kids these days.
Thing is, like, even us, like when I was a kid, I did not care about science, but let Bill Nye come on, I'm right there watching it, learning about how clouds work and how they form. In fact, I think that's how I learned how that happened, was watching Bill Nye the Science Guy, like explaining dehydration and how it actually stays in the air until it gets too heavy.
That's actually strange, because the episodes I remember most for him actually had to do with photosynthesis and color theory.
Yeah, stuff
actually.
Like that too. I didn't know plants relied on the sun that much, but no. Yeah, sure, school taught me that, but like, I didn't care what photosynthesis was. I was like, I don't. These are words I don't care about. But let Bill Nye say it. It's like, I know what that is.
That takes a talent. So yeah, Bill Nye Saves the World. It's supposed to be coming to Netflix April 21st. So very soon. Yeah, actually.
Hopefully, right around the time this episode comes out, it'll be on Netflix.
Good thing to talk
which means the next episode, chances are we're going to talk about at least the first two episodes or so.
Yes. Well, speaking of, let's move quickly from science to science fiction, because another sort of nostalgic property actually did premiere on Netflix recently, and I kind of paid a pseudo homage to it in the opening of this episode, well, mixing it together with a bit of Twilight Zone, because a certain somebody here keeps saying, "I can't sing, you dream-crushing prick." Sorry.
Hey, I can't live my dreams, neither can you. We're both going to be dreamless.
Oh, how very, very disgustingly pessimistic. I'm of course talking about the return of the comedy cult classic Mystery Science Theater 3000. And, it's really weird of me talking about it, because, oddly enough, I kind of got into the show through a friend of mine who was also a fan of the show. He found a bunch of old episodes, he had a bunch of the old DVDs, and I got into it when it actually ran on Netflix, the original show, and then the Kickstarter happens. And for some reason, for those of you who don't know what the heck this show is, for the record, I'm amazed, you're on the internet, you don't know about this. It was a show that ran in the 80s. It actually ran like on a local channel in Minneapolis or whatever at first. involving a prop comedian that basically made an entire show out of picking up these schlocky, poorly done, cheaply made, crummy science fiction and horror movies from like the 70s, 80s, 60s, I don't know, these really cheapo bits of schlock, and then basically building an entire show out of where he and like two robot buddies watch the movie and riff and joke on it. Like, they make fun of it, they, you know, they poke holes in it, they do little gags, trying to make this otherwise unwatchable piece of whatever actually entertaining. And that's basically the show. Like, each episode's like an hour and a half long, because they do show the entire movie start to finish, and they also have these, like, sketches in between, these little intermission moments, due to a framing device where the host is, like, trapped on a spaceship, and the movies he's forced to watch is part of a sanity-breaking science experiment by a mad scientist, because he wants to weaponize the schlock. It was very silly. And a lot of people grooved on the humor. In fact, if you guys ever heard of Riff Tracks, that's actually where that came from. For the original creators of the show, they went on and made that. But as I mentioned before, a Kickstarter happened, and they raised like $6 million, I think, and they got Felicia Day, who people may know from Geek and Sundry, and Patton Oswalt, to basically co-host the show and bring it back for a new generation. Like, they brought back the robots, they got a new host, they found some more cheesy, silly movies from the 70s, 80s, wherever, big old basket of crazy, and made another 14-episode season, and I have watched 4 episodes of the series so far, and it was some of the best humor I've heard in a while. Like I said before, it's an hour and a half episode, so you kind of have to sit down and actually, like, find the time for it. You know, you just, like, I sit down and get, like, a big old ball of popcorn. I'm like, okay, let's see what piece of cheesy nonsense they tear into, today. And they got some of the best jokes ever out of some of these really silly ones. There's a Danish horror movie in it called Reptilicus. There's a silly, kind of supposedly endearing childhood whimsy story about the glory of the great outdoors called Cry Wilderness. It's about Bigfoot for some reason. And probably the biggest, like, holy crud, this is hilariously awful crown jewel was a disaster movie called Avalanche, produced by Roger Corman, starring Mia Farrow and Rock Hudson. Oh, the delicious, delicious awfulness of it all.
Right, so yeah, you and I actually talked about this during a pre-recording. I don't know a whole lot about Mystery Theater 3000, because I mentioned before to you that I was not a fan of Riff Tracks. And yeah, yes. And I felt that they both had the same kind of formula. And you informed me on why that was. So for somebody like me who's not really a fan of Riff Tracks and who never really watched the original series, is this series different enough to actually be interesting, or is it the same old that could actually get me interested in watching the old stuff?
Well, like I said, I'm actually not exactly fond of Riff Tracks either. Like, I know a friend of mine who's really into them, and I caught, like, bits and pieces of those Riff Tracks, and some of them are kind of funny, like 300 and the like, and I think I mentioned The Avengers. They actually had some funny stuff there. But I brought up, I think, the reason why I like Mystery Science Theater 3000 a bit more than Riff Tracks is that Riff Tracks does modern movies, does modern filmmaking. And for a lot of people, whenever they watch a modern movie, they just want to watch the movie. When it comes to people, like, making fun of or joking about it, the immediate reaction is to be defensive, to be all, oh, what's wrong with you? Oh my god, you're some sort of snob. Oh my gosh, why would you, Because there's usually whenever you go see a movie, you want to be entertained. You don't want to go and just, bash on the hate thing. But I think the other thing is that when you go to watch a piece of schlock B movie from the 60s, and then watch a piece of schlock B movie from the 2000s, you can tell that filmmaking and film theory as a whole has come a lot farther. And because of that, something that's inherently silly or considered quote-unquote low-form cinema is still inherently more watchable and much more coherent and much more entertaining than what you see from before. And so when it comes to the riffing and the jabs at the old movies, it still comes from a place of endearment that I think is actually the core of how MST3K has endured for so long. Because if you know a guy that just hates a certain movie and won't shut up about it, it gets very annoying very fast, because you go through the same three or four jokes. Ha ha, you're stupid. Ha ha ha, whatever. Ha ha ha, this is dumb. Ha ha ha, the effects are cheap. That's lame. You know, you don't want to hear it. It gets tiring. But these guys have so many different weird combinations of humor and humor sensibilities that it stays fresh. And even then, they come from a position where they do enjoy movies. They do enjoy the cinema. But at the same time, they still want they want these movies to be a bit better. And as such, a good chunk of the humor is where it comes from. Like, there was a one from the most recent season where they were watching a long shot where they were showing like some robot being taken apart for maintenance. And the guy realized the entire scene was being done in one clean shot. No cuts, no takes. And they're watching a character, basically a robot android, which is obviously just a guy in a cheap suit, getting up on a table, and they're pulling parts off of him and, you know, his head, and replacing it with new parts. And like, oh my gosh, how did they do that? You know, is it like a fake body? But even then, the body isn't right. Like, how did they do that? Was the cut clearly hidden? We don't know. And it was a quick, like, sort of, you know, observation that showed, you know, that, you know, these guys know what they're talking about, but they're still not going to let it off the hook whenever it does something silly. Or they can't get, you know, a witty little one-liner, a little hatch-a-cha-cha-cha in between. And I think that's why I think Mystery Science Theater 3000 has a bit more over riff tracks. You can appreciate the humor and kind of groove on it because they are kind of coming from it the way we are. We're kind of spoiled with modern movies. Even at their worst made, they can still be considered better in terms of editing and technique than some of the movies they riff. And they observe that. And I think that's what gives it its charm. It also helps that the show is intercut with little sketches and jokes and sort of like these little framing devices that I think makes the show feel a bit more coherent and a bit more its own rather than just listening to a bunch of guys, jib and jab at a movie. Like the monster movie, much more Reptilicus. There's an intercut scene where they actually have a bizarre musical number about the variety of different killer monsters there are in the world, and I, for some reason, couldn't stop laughing. It isn't just criticism. They also make the criticism a form of creative art in and of itself, much like how Doug Walker, the Nostalgia Critic, and Link Hara and Angry Joe have done on YouTube, and I think that's kind of the same kind of vibe.
So what you're saying is I'm probably not going to enjoy the show. actually, you know what? I think I'll try to give at least one episode a shot. So, like, how modern do they actually do movies? Like, early 2000s or, like, anything that they find on Netflix?
I'm not going to lie. A lot of these movies, I have no idea where the heck they found them. Like I said, the most modern one, and I'm being very generous with this phrase, was Avalanche. That looked like it was like roughly made in the 80s, and I recognize the actors in it, Rock Hudson and Mia Farrow, respectively. Everything else is either cheaply made with a bunch of virtual unknowns, or made in another country or something, or, you know, was lost to the annals of time for good reason.
Okay, so like, I have a better chance of making fun of the very first, the actual very first Fantastic Four movie, and instead of like the more modernized Fantastic Four.
That's what I'm trying to say. Riff Tracks is meant more for modern stuff. MST3K kind of goes through the forgotten movies of the 70s, 80s, and 60s. You know, the kind of stuff they just like throw up in like drive-through theaters or something, or the like, and. And I mean the literal forgettable ones that make, like, no sense. Not the good stuff you remember from watching in school, like the Fantastic Voyage or H.G. Wells' The Time Machine. We're talking really dumb ones, like I mentioned before, you know, stuff like The Time Travelers or Space Mutiny or Manos, The Hands of Fate. You know, just real bomb-of-the-barrel schlock.
Okay, actually, that sounds kind of fun. I can imagine something like that, because I do know back when it was on TV, they did, I know they did a lot of black and white movies too. Yeah, yes, and I was always, and I always thought like, oh, I'm not going to get the references or the jokes because I didn't watch those movies, which is why a lot of the more modern stuff would work, and which is why I thought of like riff tracks, but I don't know.
Well, that's the weird thing. Though. Like the movies were old, but the show came out in the 80s or the 90s, so if they ever did any pop culture references or jokes, they would be from the 80s and 90s pop culture references. And the New Mystery Science Theater actually does have some modern references and modern jokes, like... Once again, going back to a particular episode, there was a part in the movie where a character, almost for like no reason, started breaking down laughing or crying in a really weird way, even though people like died in the most previous scene. And the host was like, "Oh, I'm so sorry. I saw a really funny episode of Rick and Morty last night, and I lost it."
Okay, well, so they're pretty much unscripted.
It sounds like they're unscripted. They give the illusion that they are actually just, you know, sitting in a theater, just, you know, improvising.
Okay, because like with something similar to that, I watch not honest trailers, but I watch Everything Wrong With on YouTube. Is this something similar to that? Because
I wouldn't say that. CinemaSins is very pedantic and very nitpicky. MST3K actually kind of grooves on the badness and even then just kind of has small like asides or whatever. But when something really big happens, they do bring it up, like how the Bigfoot suit doesn't really work, or how everybody kind of forgot that there was a guy in the background that is very obviously drinking a bottle of water even though they're in the desert or something.
Okay, you know that sounds interesting. So, like, is it like an entire season on Netflix? Because I didn't put
an entire 14 episode season, and each episode, from what I can tell, is about an hour and a half long each.
So, you know, I know. Do they do any Netflix original movies? Did he riff on any of those?
Actually, no, but there was a promo where they actually riffed the first 5 minutes of the first season of Stranger Things.
Ah, man. Okay, well, hopefully season two, they'll do some Netflix original riffing. That I enjoy watching.
Like I said, I think it's kind of a built-in rule they mostly keep to the cheese and schlock of like older yesteryear, because if you go further than that, you're encroaching on riff tracks territory.
Okay, yeah. But, yeah, I can see that. That's sad to hear, but that makes sense.
But as I said, you know, Mr. Science Theater has a sort of framing device, unlike Riff Tracks. Like I said, I kind of alluded to it. Like, the host is a guy that was working at a science institute. He was on a spaceship. And then Felicia Day and Patton Oswalt, who are the supervillains, basically tricked him into looking at an SOS on the moon. And they capture him, throw him onto a satellite, and start subjecting him to these bad movies as a sort of psychological experiment on trying to weaponize bad movies or something. And they're evil, and they have like a thing in between the episodes to kind of frame it. And this is actually what I still like about the show, because the original Mystery Science Theater 3000 was on a very small budget, so they had to use a lot of stuff with miniatures and wires and really cheap-looking special effects to get the illusion of them being in space. You see, like, a little rocket ship, and it's, you know, clearly made out of styrofoam or whatever, and, you know, very low-budget, you know, homemade movie kind of vibe to it. They kept that when it came to the opening sequence and the stuff whenever they cut to, like, the moon base or the satellite of love, and I love how they kept that really kind of cheesy but endearing handmade practical effect vibe to those sections.
Man, see, okay, you really do make that sound interesting. All right, so moving on from that, we have video games to talk about. We're actually going to end this episode with video games and seeing how you're on a high right now, because, man, you're on a roll. You actually had a video game one to talk about, correct?
Yeah, I did. Like I said, I kind of burnt myself out on RPGs due to me juggling between trying to catch up on Kingdom Hearts, trying to get through my very first playthrough ever of Final Fantasy VII, courtesy of my PlayStation Vita, and powering through a fair amount of Persona 5 for review purposes on thegamefanatics.com. It's up right now, check it out. That I kind of got really sick of RPGs, which is strange because I love RPGs, but I got to the point where every time I closed my eyes, I would see spreadsheets and crunch numbers and stuff. I'm like, okay, too much, I'm done. And I decided to check out the recently released to the public Banjo-Kazooie Successor. We talked about it lightly last episode, but I decided to actually you know, put some money down and actually see for myself what has become of Playtonic Games' Yooka-Laylee. Because this game has gotten a very mixed critical reception. And it worried me. Because so many critics have either said it's good, said it's bad, or other critics have basically said, congratulations, you made a 3D platformer. Now you realize why they don't make 3D platformers anymore. This thing sucks! I'm like, oh my gosh, no, my childhood. And I wanted to see for myself just how bad it is, because I have a very passionate nostalgia for Banjo-Kazooie. I played the crap out of that when I was a kid. I 100%ed that game. I think that was like the first game I realized I could actually take a lot of enjoyment out of, getting every little collectible doodad, finding every little secret, finding every little tiny thing, and just picking the game apart. And then I did it again for the sequel, and then I got sad when Microsoft bought Rare, so we didn't get the Banjo 3E we deserved, and we do not talk about nuts and bolts. That thing is a abomination. Kill it with fire. Sorry about that. And as such, I wanted to see how the guys at Playtonic, which are made up of ex-Rare developers, how they would update the 3D platformer. And now that I have put some time into it, I can see where the critics are coming from, but I can also see where the fans are coming from. I know that sounds very wishy-washy, middle of the road, but hear me out on this. As I've been playing Yooka-Laylee, I think this is the best way I can describe this. My inner 8-year-old was having the time of his life, jumping around, collecting the quills and the pages, which are the new jigsaw pieces, the new jiggies, collecting all those little things, solving the little puzzles, figuring out where to go and all that stuff, and I'm like, yay, my little 8-year-old is having fun. My inner adult, meanwhile, wants to throttle my inner 8-year-old for having bad taste.
But you're only, eight, like... Well, actually, today's episode was about nostalgia, so by the end of this episode, we will talk about our nostalgias and how that actually affected us. Because in the last episode, I did talk about my fear of nostalgia and Voodoo Vince, and you were afraid about Yooka-Laylee, so please continue about your poor 8-year-old's taste.
My experience. Yeah, you see, that's the drill problem. Like, on the one hand, I do appreciate that Playtonic basically recreated the 90s, the late 90s mascot platformer of 3D, and I do like parts of how they have updated and changed things. Like, I do like how you actually have to spend some of your pages to actually add more to the world, to the level you're in, so there's more to explore and more to look for. And I like... I like how they basically reskinned Banjo-Kazooie. Like, I hate to say that, but Yooka and Laylee are basically the exact same character types as Banjo-Kazooie. Yooka is the well-meaning can-do guy, and Laylee is this kind of foul-mouthed, backhanded kind of mean, sassy companion, and they get along, and that's the same thing as Banjo and Kazooie. And there are some good things I do like, but there's also some bad stuff that I remember not getting really angry about. Like, Banjo-Kazooie had a thing where at the very end of the game, before he gets to the final battle against the evil witch Gruntilda, there was a quiz show section where you would have to answer questions, very, very pedantic questions about certain details in the world of the many, many, many levels you've gone through in the game. Stuff like, okay, in the sand level, how many jigsaw pieces were found in the left foothold in the right hemisphere of the level on a Tuesday? And you get like a multiple choice answer for it. And if you failed too many times, you would die, so you couldn't get to the end. I thought that was fun and annoying at the same time, because it showed how much detail they put into small little things and how much they basically assumed that because you were trying to explore and look for stuff, you would pick up on these little details, and I liked that. The problem, though, is in Yooka-Laylee, that basically replaces boss battles. There is a boss battle in each world, but in order for you to get to the next area in the hub area to get to the next world, it is intercut with these quizzes. One quiz in the game is fine. There's five. As far as I can tell, there's supposed to be five, like one every other time, focusing on the one world you're on. On the one hand, that's more focused. On the other hand, ooh, it is annoying.
Okay, see, yeah, so it seems, so it sounds like it brought back problems of the old 90s 3D platformers.
It seems to try to get at it. It's good and it's bad. Like here's something else as well. They also brought back the whole thing where you have to find like a collectible doodad in order to, and give it to a secondary character so you get transformed, so you have like an alternate form in a certain world, in order to, you know, get more pages or solve more puzzles. There's a moment in the second world, Glitter Glaze Glacier, where you get a transformation where you turn into a plow truck, and you need to do that in order to remove the snow in order to find these missing hats for these snowmen. It's part of another like little quest. And I thought, that's fine. But then I found out that the truck has really terrible handling. It cannot turn on a dime to save its life. In order to get certain sections, there is some precision platforming you gotta do.
Okay.
Do you feel the pain?
Yeah, it sounds like it really is. Like, they didn't change up enough to be like, oh, well, yeah, it's reminiscence of old 90s / early 2003 platformers.
But at the same time, that stuff was experimental at the time. There were certain problems with the thing. And 20 years kind of changes the stuff. And that thing is why Yooka-Laylee has kind of been sitting at like a 70 average. It didn't transcend. It didn't evolve to meet the modern standards. Like, it didn't pull a Shovel Knight. It didn't keep the old while trying to improve it. It stayed with the old and touched it up and just brought it back. And on the one hand, I'm glad that happened, because part of me does wish for a return to mascot collect-a-thon platformers. I actually do like the more mellow and more kind of laid-back design philosophy that I think has been lost because of how much gaming has been pandering to the more action ADD-oriented, overstimulation stuff for the more older demographic. And I kind of like this more mellow feel to it, and I do like parts of the game. It's just that I wish they remembered certain design fundamentals about handling and precision and things like that, because it can get very annoying and not in a challenging way, and it's so very hard to mess. It's very, very easy to mess that up. And I was expecting a bit more. But having said that, like I said, this isn't a bad game. From what I can tell, if you love Banjo-Kazooie and still have nostalgia for it, you will get your money's worth. It's just that you're going to have to reevaluate and take off the rose-tinted nostalgia glasses in order to understand where certain critics are coming from. Like, the most harshest review I saw for this game was actually by Jim Sterling. He gave the game a 2 out of 10 because he just flat-out could not stand 3D platforming at all. He had no love for any of the old nostalgia platformers. I found every element of the game to be annoying. Like how Banjo-Kazooie, have whenever characters talk, they do these little grunts and squeaks and these little grunts, these instead of dialogue. And I liked that. I liked those little shout-outs. I like that sort of return, that little, nostalgia thing. He hated it. There's like a little shout outs to past games, like there's a Mr. Pants reference, or the fact that ice keys are used in the ice level, stuff like that. I thought that was cute, went over his head. So that shows my bias, but it also shows just how very obviously aimed this game is.
Man, see, okay, that still sounds like a rough path for me, because I have a love-hate relationship with 3D platformers. Was one reason why I really dislike Kingdom Hearts 1, amongst other things.
The platforming in Kingdom Hearts 1 does not age well at all. That does make it a chore.
Yeah, I didn't think so. And what you're saying is very similar to the issues I've had with Voodoo Vince.
So I've had my discussion. Let's hear your return to Voodoo Vince.
Well, before actually into Voodoo Vince, your final thought, is Yooka-Laylee worth picking up if you're a fan of old 3D platformers?
I will say a point in its favor is that the game is releasing for $40 instead of a full price $60. I think that was very smart by Playtonic. Because if it was at a full price, I would say absolutely not. I would say there's nowhere near enough content to justify that. At $40, however, I would totally be fine with that. In fact, if it wasn't In fact, if it wasn't being delayed, I would have initially paid for this to play on my Nintendo Switch. Instead, I picked it up on my PS4 because I think that actually would be much more endearing to have on the go and just sort of mellow, you know, just very lazily plow through. But I would say if you're a big fan of Banjo-Kazooie, you're going to get what you paid for. You're going to get exactly what you have. So I would say I would recommend it with that very big caveat. However, be prepared to remember the bad as well as the good when it comes to Banjo-Kazooie.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. Okay, well, you said it was $40 for this new adventure?
That's right. It's $40.
Okay. Well, oh, man. All right, here we go. Rude events. In the last episode, just like you, how you had a love for 3D platformers because, you know, that was a thing from when we were growing up. That was Mario.
Mario 64, Banjo-Kazooie. Conker's Bad Fur Day.
Yeah, Gex. All that fun stuff, especially Gex. I love Gex. I think I have the original Gex on my PlayStation 3. But nostalgia, people. Luckily, I too am able to remove my rose tinted glasses. I've recently had the pleasure of receiving a review copy of Voodoo Vents Remastered. So you can take my opinion for this game with a grain of salt, well, not with a grain of salt, but with a little more exclusivity than with Tyler's, because he actually had to pay for his game.
I pay for my copy, although, and I am not playing the game for review purposes, although I am writing a think piece about it for the Game Fanatics.
Okay. Yeah. So you got to enjoy your game the way it's meant to be enjoyed. The good thing is, I too was able to play this game for enjoyment. Even though I knew I was going to review it, I was able to play it for enjoyment because since I'm doing freelance now, I don't have to worry about a deadline and I don't have to worry about editors. So that's one of the great things about being able to do this now. Voodoo Vents Remastered is an odd little duckling. It was one of the games back when Microsoft remembered that it back when Microsoft was actually a game a game system seller, when they used to sell actual game consoles and not all-in-one multimedia platform nonsense.
If I recall, this was on the original Xbox back when they were trying to, you know, kind of find their place with other stuff like Grab by the Goonies, Blinks.
Yeah, back on the original Xbox when Microsoft tried their hardest to actually make first party titles and they make mascots and to make something interesting before the 360 kind of gave way to dude bro shooters and racers and sports.
Yeah, because Halo sold and they found their demographic. This is during the more experimental time of Microsoft's dip into console.
Granted, it was more experimental time for all the industry. There was experimental games on the GameCube. Was experimental games on the PlayStation 2. And there was even experimental games on the Xbox. So, like, everybody was going through that phase.
Everybody was trying to see what we could do with the new processing. Like, stuff, and, of course, great stuff came out of it. The Wind Waker, Metal Gear Solid 2,
yep,
et cetera.
Yeah. Even Halo, like, for first-person shooters, Halo was a game-changer for consoles.
Oh, absolutely. So, yeah, Voodoo Vents is kind of in that same kind of vein of these these sort of mascot platformers released on the Xbox that was mostly selling on novelty, as far as I can tell.
Yeah, yeah, you know? Yeah. And so Voodoo Vents Remastered, I was a fan of Voodoo Vents back on the original Xbox. Now, mind you, just like Tyler, I was a kid, so taste change. As a kid, yeah, you thought 3D platformers were fun and whatnot, but as adults, your patience isn't the same anymore. You know,
It is okay to accept that, by the way. Yeah. It's okay to accept that. It's okay to accept that your childhood was full of bad decisions.
It was, because I've played games back in the past where I was like, oh, wow, I remember this game being so much fun. The player's like, yeah, no, this is garbage. Why did I like this?
You betrayed me, yeah. Nostalgia.
But I'm somewhat happy to say that Voodoo Vents holds up to today's standards. But, oh, yeah.
Really? Oh, wait, we're hearing a butt, a big old hairy butt.
But it still suffers from 3D platforming issues of yesteryear. Fighting the camera, tight spaces, and weird geometries in the world.
Yep, those are also problems I have with Yooka-Laylee. These are universal issues. Like, for some reason, the camera just can't keep still, and the messes up
platforming. It does, and this is the reason why 3D platforming died in the first place. Gamers have gotten used to having more control than ever before, and 3D platforming sometimes just does not allow that because the camera has to be set in a certain way. And with Voodoo Vents,
and whenever control gets taken away, it can be jarring. Oh yeah,
definitely frustrating when you're trying to land certain platforms and you know what angle you want the camera to be at so you can look at it, but the camera wants to move behind the character anyway.
Here's something even worse for you. You're in the middle of the jump, and while you're jumping, the camera swings around to a different spot.
Yes, Voodoo Vents has that issue. But one, the game looks like the original Xbox version. They didn't
just up-resed, I'm guessing.
Yeah. It's been raised up for HD quality, so that way nothing looks like garbage. Because it looks nice. It looks like if the original Xbox was able to run at least 720p, 900p HD, it would look better than your composite cables. Yeah, that's so good. They got it to work on the Xbox One. But unfortunately, they didn't really touch up on a whole lot. Like, it looks like original Xbox. And nowadays, we're so used to remasters actually being remasters. It's like,
ground up. They do the textures, add environmental effects, all this stuff.
Adding new effects, work on the textures. Even if it's just upping the textures a little bit, like, and that's my problem with, Voodoo Vents Remastered right now, is as soon as you boot up the game, you look at it, you're like, wow, this looks like I'm playing my original Xbox. Why am I not just playing this on my original Xbox? And it works because
people are lazy.
Well, that and some people just don't have original Xboxes or the copy of Voodoo Vents. And while playing this game, I saw what they were going for. They were going for the original Voodoo Vents for a new generation, and it kind of works. The only issues is, again, like I said, the camera. Yeah, I have to fight the camera, which nowadays the new generation.
I guess it isn't really for the new generation.
Older generation like you and I, and even even people who first exposure was GoldenEye and Mario 64, and they understand fighting the cameras,
the limitations,
yeah.
And the
I got used to it rather quickly. It's like, oh wow, I forgot how much you had to fight the camera in these old platformers, and with this,
but that just won't fly.
Yeah, and with this, the newer generations will look just like, wow, why isn't this camera holding still? Why isn't it staying where I want to put it? And make it even worse, certain parts the camera's fixed. The camera's fixed. It happens with certain boss battles. I was trying to time a certain boss. The first boss battle, I've died twice because I tried to aim the camera at the boss so I could time my jumps. And every time I moved Vince, the camera would swoop around behind him, and I had to go off of sound cues instead. And I was like, wow, I kind of forgot all about this. There's certain parts where Vince has to go through closed off spaces, and the camera goes crazy because if you land vents in a certain way, the camera, the areas are solid, so the camera won't go through objects. So instead, it'll bounce off of objects and it'll go in weird angles, and you have to fight the camera to make sure you know where you're jumping to next. Because if there's something that you're supposed to grab on the ledge, there's a lot of stuff on ledges. You have to inch your way over there and try to get the camera in the right spot so you don't fall to your death. Because this is a platformer that has a lot of bottomless pits. Just like the Mario 64 days, you go off the edge of the map, instant death. So Voodoo Vents has that going for it, but at the same time, it's so enjoyable because the game is just flat out creative. While playing the game, I was like, wow, games...
You think the novelty still holds
absolutely,
up?
Absolutely, because it reminds me how creative those games were. Each level, like, yeah, you're doing more platforming, but the levels themselves are interesting. Like, it's great level design. It's a bit of a collectathon, but you don't have to collect everything in order to move on. You only have to collect certain pieces of the objective, and all those are puzzles. Okay, you have to go through this gate by playing with this jazz man. It's like, oh, how do I do that? Well, first you got to figure out how to get the get the trumpet, which is in a pawn shop. Well, if you look around the level, you'll find you can find certain shops and even a costume contest. Okay, how do I win the costume contest? Find a costume, go through the level, find a costume, win the money, get the trumpet, talk to a jazz man. Simple stuff like that. But
this sounds more like Psychonauts or Grim Fandango, honestly. You know,
and I'm a fan of Psychonauts too. And yeah, so am I. And you know, that's what makes Voodoo Vince so great and why I still enjoy it now and why I say it still holds up, because it has that creativity and even the most mundane things is interesting because the level design is interesting and everything has a purpose. It's not just run around, collect all 10 right. of these, okay, you're good, or run around, do the same thing. It's like, no, each level, each platform is a different challenge. And even when you think you're sick of platforming, it throws something new at you. It's like, okay, now fly this plane, ride this loincloth, this basket full of clothes down this line, hopping line to line, trying not to hit these frying pans right. while collecting t-shirts.
Right.
Yeah, it's so fun. It reminds me why I love 3D platforming in the first place, is because the levels themselves are okay. the challenge.
All right, cool. Now for the big punch. How much will this look at nostalgic platformings of yesteryear cost you?
It's only $15.
$15?
Yep, it's only $15, and it'll be on Xbox Live digitally. It's going to be on digital on Xbox One, Windows 10, and Steam. So even if you don't want to use Windows, you can get it on Steam.
Oh.
And...
Yeah. Okay, but like plug it in a controller and
yeah.
play that one.
And
okay.
if you liked 3D platforming, I highly recommend it. It will remind you why 3D platforming was so frustrating but was such a joy. And if you're new to 3D platforming, yeah, this is going to be a trial and error kind of frustration time for you. But for $15, it's a good risk, and it's definitely a game just like Blinks the Time Sweeper that I feel that a lot of people should really know about and try out.
Very underappreciated. Okay. All right. I think we have gone a bit more over our usual time for that random podcast show.
Yeah, but
we
also had like a lot more to talk about this time around.
And we got to drone on about our nostalgia and bore half of our audience to tears, all five of them. Sorry about that. But if you do want to pick our brains more about our thoughts on game design, game theory, movies, more recent stuff, you can, of course, bug us on social media. You can follow me on Twitter at DarthRahu, capital D, capital R, all one word, and I do some more long-form written analysis and discussion on my blog, cybertavern.blogspot.com. Michael, where can we follow you?
You can, of course, follow me on Twitter at @M_MOSLEY_JR. Or you can even find me on Twitter with Zafmod, ZAFMOD, if for some strange reason you can't find me that way. And yes, I'm doing more streaming now. So down in the description, you can find links to my Twitch and my Beam.
Awesome. And I have been fooling around with the idea of bringing back my Twitch account as well, doing some PS4 console streaming of certain interesting gems or like. We'll keep you posted there when that becomes more of a thing. So, until next time, ladies and gentlemen, we shall bid you all adieu. Push the button, Max.
Button pushed.